I'm very pleased to introduce our speaker today, Ruth Levine from the Center for Global Development. She is an economist, and economists have had key roles and key voices in health and in global health. Her work has been broadly reaching, concerned with many issues of policy, health, and global development. The Center for Global Development, and I think probably in large part due to Ruth, has been very productive and prolific in bringing out key volumes and reports that bring together summaries of information on global health and key messages about steps forward. They've proved valuable to us, her case study book for teaching at all levels. So we're very pleased that Ruth could come here. It turns out that she's never been in Los Angeles before, so this is an opportunity to get Ruth here, and in her spare 10 minutes, maybe she'll see a little bit of Los Angeles. Her talk, Global Health Forecast, the Next 20 Years. Ruth, and thank you for coming.
Thanks very much. Let me turn on my... Does this work? Can you hear me? Yeah. Oh, that might be a little loud.
Do you want me to get your water?
I think I'm okay, thanks. All right, thank you so much, John. It's really a real pleasure to be here, and thanks to those who came, who chose to spend their Monday evening here. What I thought I'd do first is just say a couple of words about the Center for Global Development, because it might not be exactly a household name, and then launch into the talk. So the Center for Global Development is about 9 years old. It's a think tank in Washington, so we do policy research, and we're focused on how the policies of the U.S. and other wealthy countries affect the prospects for development of low and middle-income countries, which is a very large agenda, and we're not very big. And so we split our work into looking at issues of debt, climate change, aid, so development assistance and the effectiveness of aid, trade and migration, which are kind of some of the major dimensions of globalization. And as John said, we try to develop analytic work and synthesize some of the work that others are doing around some key policy questions. And I, in particular, work on how donors to global health programs can make their resources work better and get more health for the money. One of the things I've found in my work at the center over the past 9 years or so is that there are a lot of people who are interested in working in global health, and particularly a lot of young people coming out of medical school, coming out of undergraduate and master's programs. And so when I think about what they need to be concerned with, I think, well, they need to really be thinking not just about what the global health needs are of today, but they need to be looking into the future and preparing themselves to be to provide ideas and technical contributions and political contributions in the future. So in this presentation, what I'm hoping to do over the next, 40 minutes or so, is challenge what might be your image of who and what constitutes the global health agenda. And I'd like to think with you, and maybe in a conversation, since it's a pretty small group, about how to reach a healthier global future. So just think for a minute, what is your image of global health? Maybe it's a child becoming immunized with life-saving vaccines. Maybe it's a mom in South Asia giving oral rehydration solution to her baby who would otherwise die of dehydration from diarrheal disease. Maybe it's the eradication of smallpox, which has to be one of the most influential successes in global health and really was the spark that stirred the interest of many of the people who have set the global health agenda that we have today. Maybe it's a malaria bed net. Maybe you've chipped in your $10 for a malaria bed net. Maybe you've even worked in NGOs that deliver bed nets to families in Africa. Maybe it's Paul Farmer and his remarkable work in rural Haiti in Kanj. Maybe it's Angelina Jolie and Bono. Maybe these are all the images of global health that are so present in today's discussions and that frankly have stimulated a huge amount of interest on the part of this generation. The global health focus of the recent past and even the distant past, and I would argue much of the global health focus today, is on health in rural areas. It's on the health of babies and young mothers. It's on infectious diseases, and in the past 10 years, very much on the fight against HIV/AIDS, but increasingly with focus on TB, malaria, and the sort of traditional agenda of infectious diseases. And the how of global health is very much around expanding primary health infrastructure into rural areas, developing and delivering vaccines and other basic care, and again, in recent years, the extension of life-extending antiretrovirals to those who have AIDS. It is in some ways about otherness. That is about diseases and ailments that affect people who are not in the industrialized world. It's also to some extent about innocence. That's been challenged a little bit in the discussions around HIV/AIDS, but the sort of core of global health has been around the spread of infectious diseases among people who cannot protect themselves, babies and mothers. And it's about fix it and move on. I think the quintessential example of that is immunization campaigns, where you can provide solid immunity through one dose, two doses, three doses of a vaccine. So I'm not saying that comprises the entirety of global health, but I think if you reflect on what the sort of core images, not just in the media, but in curricula, in the minds of people who work in global health is, it is very much about this image. And the donor spending has corresponded to this, and we can talk about what's chicken and what's egg here. But what this shows is the U.S. global health spending between 2001 and last year on global health programs. So this is largely programs implemented through USAID, the Centers for Disease Control, and other branches of government, including the Department of Defense. And what you see is the lower sort of bluish purple is maternal and child health programs. Then you see in the maroon, family planning and reproductive health programs, other infectious diseases, and then the white bars or the light blue bars represent the growth in the spending on HIV/AIDS prevention and particularly care and treatment programs. So that's what U.S. spending looks like. The U.S. provides about a third of all global health resources from donors, and many other donors basically have corresponding patterns of spending. So there's a whole segment of types of health problems that are not included in this. So this is basically MCH, reproductive health, and HIV/AIDS. And the emphasis, what the money has been used for, is buying drugs and vaccines, providing technical assistance, primarily to expand access to, not necessarily quality of services for these types of health conditions. And research and development monies, largely, there certainly aren't an enormous amount of resources that go to R&D for products that disproportionately benefit developing countries. But those that are available are going to products such as development of products such as the malaria vaccine, HIV vaccine for the types of disease that affect Africa, and other diagnostic and treatment products for infectious disease. You know, the Aymara Indians of South America have a metaphor about the future, which is that they look back to the future, that they're walking backwards, and that what they can see is the past, and they're walking backwards into the future because they can't see it. And so I think that in some ways, many ways, when we think about what the future holds, we are basing it on what the past looked like. And so hopefully with this presentation, I can help us all turn around. I think that in many ways, the global health agenda of today is ignoring five trends that shape the future, inexorably shape the future. The first two are demographic. We are all aging, and we are all, or almost all, moving to cities. Epidemiologic. We are all sick with non-communicable diseases, and I mean all populations. Environmental forces are at play with climate change and the consequential effects on health. And there are economic forces at work, which are also really inexorable, that the economic center of gravity is shifting toward the east. So I'm going to walk through each of those and sort of think with you about how that tells a tale about what the future of global health will look like. And to some extent, what the present looks like if we'd open our eyes. First is the demographic shifts and the increase in the average age in all regions of the world. Primarily a function of the really impressive declines in fertility, so on average, fewer babies born to every woman, combined with improved health, largely attributable to control of infectious diseases and increases in standard of living, means longer lives and older populations on average. What the chart shows is for the most developed parts of the world, high-income countries, middle-income countries, and low-income countries, the share of the population that is now and will be 60 years and older. So you can see in the green just really dramatic increases. Out to 2025, almost a third of the, somewhere between a quarter and a third of the population over 60. In middle-income countries, somewhere close to 14% of the population by 2025. And even in the least developed countries, that is with incomes under $1,000 per capita every year, a trend toward increasing share of the population in the older age group. And here again in the chart, you see a kind of reiteration of that pattern. This shows the average age between 1950 and 2020, shifting in the more developed parts of the world from somewhere around 28 years in 1950 to 42 by 2020. And again, corresponding, although lower patterns, lower levels in the other part, in the developing regions of the world. With aging comes a shift in the disease burden, and I'll talk about that in a moment. An increase in the demands for different types of healthcare, longer-term healthcare and interventions. And importantly, a change in the capacity to finance healthcare. So for countries where a large share of the population is aging into the working age groups, the productive age groups, there's actually a real opportunity for economic growth and potentially even for some savings and preparation for establishing better financing for care in the future. For the countries like our own, where such a large portion is moving into the older age groups, we face, as you know, a tremendous challenge in terms of financing. Second major force is urbanization, and I know many people here are concerned with that. I guess you can't live in LA without being concerned about urbanization. What the chart shows is between 1950 at the bottom and 2030 on the top, the share of the population in major world regions, Latin America, Asia, and Africa, which will be in urban areas. So even in, if you project out to 2030, 20 years from now, even in Africa, which you don't think about as necessarily an urbanizing region, almost 50% of the population will live in urban areas. The growth of the megacities, Rio, Lagos, Delhi, is slowing, but the growth of the smaller secondary cities is increasing, so that in the future, the large share of the urban population will be in centers of 500,000 or less, which have very limited institutional capacity to absorb the inflows. By 2030, 5 billion people in this world will live in cities. This is just a picture of Rio, I believe. This is a picture from Manila of children picking garbage. And I believe this is from Delhi, children eking out a living on the sidewalks of the city. The implications of urbanization are many, and just to summarize a few. Certainly, huge pressures on infrastructure, including health, and complications associated with, well, many things, but including municipal jurisdiction, because many of the slum areas are actually outside the official boundaries of the city, and so it's kind of no man's land in terms of who is responsible for making sure that those areas are serviced. Serious environmental exposures, John is an expert on that, as are others here. There are new health challenges, but there are also new opportunities. With greater population density comes the opportunity to institute and foster new models of care, whether it's by the private sector or the public sector. And there are some interesting franchise models that have been developed, some interesting urban outreach efforts where the trying to overcome household barriers, where the problem is not distance to a health facility, but rather cultural and social and financial barriers to care. There are also opportunities, and I'm not an expert in this, but there are opportunities, I think, in urban environments to leverage the kind of network effects related to health behaviors. So as you know, health behaviors are essentially contagious. That is, if your neighbors are doing something, if your friends are doing something, either good or bad for their health, it spreads to their social contacts. And I think that the potential for using those social networks within urban environments is potentially very great in terms of changing behavior. And then there's also a greater potential for political empowerment and action within urban settings where people can gather, they can more easily get access to information, and can be more visible to political leaders than in rural areas. Third inexorable force, related very much to the aging of the population and to some extent to urbanization, is the growing burden of chronic disease. So what you have on the, oh dear, that didn't translate very well from my Mac to the PC, sorry about that. So what you have is deaths to non-communicable diseases for upper middle income countries, lower middle-income countries and the poorest countries from 2005 projected to 2030 in millions. And so what you see is the tremendous growth over that time period in the burden of non-communicable diseases. And in the chart, what you see is the relative ranking of heart disease, cardiovascular disease, lower respiratory infection, chronic pulmonary disease, diarrheal disease, HIV, TB, diabetes, and malaria. And I think it's quite clear that in terms of relative importance, what's going to happen is a significant reduction in the toll of diarrheal disease, TB, and malaria, with a corresponding really very significant increase in terms of diabetes and other chronic conditions. And what's interesting to me about this is that heart disease and cardiovascular disease are now numbers one and two, despite the kind of image in global health that now that the challenges are in infectious diseases alone. Let me just highlight the point for cardiovascular or coronary heart disease. There's projected to be 120 to 140% increase in mortality in developing countries between 1990 and 2020. And currently in Pakistan, it's estimated that 30% of the middle-aged population has coronary vascular disease. Diabetes, an increase from 171 million to 366 million between 2000 and 2030 worldwide, with 86% in developing countries in 2030. And in Tanzania right now, it's estimated that of the population 35 years and older, about 10% have diabetes. Cancer, it is projected that there'll be a 50% increase between 2000 and 2025. So this is really, when you think about what the future health problems are, and to some extent the current health problems, this is really where it's at. Recognizing that there's a tremendous unfinished agenda, as they call it, and work to be done on maternal and child health care and the control of infectious diseases, and certainly HIV/AIDS. I think we can't take our eye off the growing problems of chronic disease, which affect not just the old. What this chart shows is for a number of different countries, what the age standardized death rates are among people in the productive ages, so say 30 to 69 years. And what you see is that in the United Kingdom, which is here, so in England, has a much lower death rates in that age group than any of the developing regions, Nigeria, Pakistan, Brazil, and Tanzania. It's affecting those in the productive years, and it's affecting those who are poor. These are often thought of as diseases of affluence, but when you look at the risk behaviors for at least some diseases by income group or by wealth quintile, what you see, and this is from India, what you see is that the poorest segments of the populations are very heavily affected by key risk factors, and in fact suffer from chronic diseases typically in a larger proportion than their wealthier fellow citizens. Why is there such a heavy burden of non-communicable diseases in even the lowest income countries and the poorest populations? Well, one reason is that it's a function of the success of control of infectious diseases and the aging of the corresponding aging of the population, and the very, very rapid and pernicious spread of risk factors and unhealthy behaviors and environments that, whether they're policy environments or physical environments, that have led to a rapid increase in unhealthful behavior, tobacco use, unhealthy diets, and physical activity. Let me just give you one example of what I mean by unhealthy policy environments with respect to diet. Many countries heavily subsidize sugars, fats, and other ingredients, other parts of the diet that are, in fact, leading to obesity, while lower fat options, higher quality foods are relatively higher priced because they don't have those public sector subsidies. The lifestyle, and I put that in quotes because lifestyle sort of makes it seem like it's every individual's decision, where I think that there are much bigger environmental forces at work. But the lifestyle risks are growing, and what this shows is for 2005 on the right and 2015 projected on the left, the prevalence of overweight among women 30 years and above. And what you can see is the projected increase and intensification of this risk factor really spreading throughout the developing world. In places where you think that the core nutrition problem is childhood undernutrition, and really very often what you find is that childhood undernutrition coexists often in the same household with overweight and obesity. The implications of the heavy burden of non-communicable diseases are many. This just illustrates the projected foregone national income due to heart disease, stroke, and diabetes in selected countries. And you can easily see that China, because of the size of the population and the burden of communicable disease, non-communicable disease in that country, is slated to lose, according to this model, about $600 billion during that time period. So that's from reduced productivity, and then there are also very directly very high healthcare costs associated with treating these diseases. Fourth, just very quickly, because there's not actually much empirical information yet about this, is the likely health effects of climate change. With shifts in global temperature, there are changes in the kind of geographic distribution of parasites, of malaria, mosquitoes, and consequently changes in who's exposed to disease. There's certainly now and likely to be more severity of extreme weather conditions and changes in food supply. The impacts on food production, particularly in Africa, are likely to be really very profound, worsening both the quality and the quantity of food. But climate change actually depresses me so much that I can't talk about it too much. So fifth of the five inexorable trends that are shaping what global health looks like in the future has to do with economic activity. And I'll just repeat what I'm sure you all know, which is how rapidly the U.S., the growth in income in the U.S., Western Europe, Canada, has been outpaced by the growth in income in India, China, Brazil, and many, many countries in the developing world who aren't as large and powerful as those. And so what this shows is that by 19, it's a little fuzzy, but it shows that by 2050, there's an expectation that China will be really significantly larger economy than the U.S., with India not far behind. Now, the per capita income of certainly India and China will be much, much lower than the per capita income of the U.S. under any scenario. But the size of those populations means that there's a huge market. And the important thing about it is that it's rapidly growing. And so firms, when they look where to invest, where their market opportunities are, they're looking for year-on-year and sometimes quarter-on-quarter growth, not just staying even, but growth. And the growth that they see as potential is largely in the large developing countries. And this is particularly true for the pharmaceutical industry, which when it's looking around for economic opportunities, sees China, sees India, sees Brazil, South Africa, as huge and largely untapped markets, and also environments to do clinical trials in, which is a very fast-growing phenomenon. So the interest of industry in general in these parts of the world, and certainly the pharmaceutical industry, is huge, which has implications for health. So I've talked about five, two demographic and epidemiologic, environmental, and economic forces that really should challenge a bit our image, if we had them, of the rural mom and baby getting vaccines and being well served by how donors are spending their resources today. The donor focus, as I've said, is rooted in the past and at the same time reactive to emergencies, and that's basically the framework under which the resources for HIV/AIDS have been made available, is as emergency, not as, oh, well, this is a chronic condition that we have to provide care for over a long period of time. And to put a fine point on that, on average, there's about $16 that per capita that goes in low-income countries donor aid that goes into global health every year. And of that, a whopping 78 cents goes to chronic diseases. The rest goes to HIV/AIDS, maternal health, and reproductive health, and other infectious diseases. Perhaps more alarmingly is that for the most part, developing country governments do not have in place either a sort of policy framework or a delivery approach that is oriented toward chronic disease prevention or care, and or financing either prevention or care. And I really focus on, would like us all to focus on prevention, because there's a kind of window of opportunity now for the prevention of the diseases that are projected to be so dominant in coming years. The pharmaceutical industry is perhaps more prepared than any of us because it's looking at the future, at the current and future market, and in some ways helping to export a kind of Western model, not only of intellectual property, but of the kinds of drug therapies that are and other types of therapies that are sort of characterize our medical care. So we're not really prepared for what's ahead. And as far as I can tell, very few organizations are preparing. John just came back from a meeting which suggests that there are certainly some who have their eye on the ball, but I think in general it's a vanguard and not the majority. So what's potentially a better way? Well, you know, no magic answers here whatsoever. But I think that there are a few, and they have to do with thinking about these forces not as enemies of health, but rather as phenomena that will happen and that can be leveraged, can be used in a way for better health. So one is around embracing urbanization, where I think that there's a tremendous potential, as I've tried to suggest earlier, for new models of financing and delivery to be developed that actually are more efficient ways of providing quality healthcare than can ever be managed in rural settings. Cities are where health workers want to live, so you don't have to pay them extra the way you do to extend care into rural areas. People are near to services for the most part. So you have to figure out, well, what are the barriers that you have to overcome, but they're not geographic barriers. And as I said earlier, I think there's potentially very important efforts that can be made to organize communities politically to insist on their rights to access to quality services. And there are some interesting examples of how that's been done. For example, using geographic information system mapping to show people in poor urban communities in India how few services are public services are available in their neighborhoods and how many are available in neighborhoods that are better off. And then using that information, which is accessible to people who can't necessarily read, to do political organizing and demand of their public officials greater attention. I think it's also, I don't know how to do this, but I think that there's also an important agenda about seizing the moment for prevention of non-communicable diseases by, for example, influencing what the built environment looks like in urban areas, making sure that there's consideration of public spaces for physical activity and so forth. Or doing what's done in, where is it? Is it, it's not Bogota, Cali, Colombia, where they, every Sunday, they close all the streets and only permit bicycles. And then learning how to affect behavioral change. And that's, of course, easier said than done, but it's clearly a core aspect is how to get people to make better choices about what they eat and how to get policymakers to create environments that facilitate that. And then I think in terms of access to medicines, there's a tremendous potential embodied in the emerging pharmaceutical industry in India and China. Clearly some huge quality issues, and we can talk about that. But the advantage that those firms have is that they are not growing up in an expectation of blockbuster drugs where they make huge profits on every unit sold. Rather, their business model is to make relatively inexpensive, often generic drugs, and have a small profit margin on a large volume. So I don't know if any of you are thinking about global health as a career, but I think that many who are have to think about, well, am I going to follow where the money is today, which is in HIV/AIDS and infectious disease and to some extent maternal and child health care, or am I going to keep my eye on what's needed in the future? And I think that there is a really vast opportunity to contribute in both those domains, but I challenge you to think about, well, maybe I can be the best in diabetes prevention instead of the next person to think about diarrheal disease control. And I think that there's also a big opportunity to really be global in how we think about global health and consider the ways in which with the convergence of health conditions and urban environments and so forth between what we think of as the industrialized and the developing world, there are a lot of common issues. We may have to take somewhat different approaches, but questions about how to affect health-related behaviors, questions about what delivery models work to reach the urban poor, I think are as relevant for the US as they are in developing countries. So again, I don't know if any of you are planning careers in global health, but I think that it's very much up to you to help define whether we stay rooted in the past or really acknowledge the forces that are before us and upon us. And I'd invite you to join a sort of ongoing conversation about global health priorities and other related topics that we have on our blog and at the Center for Global Development, and we really invite comments and try to make the materials that we produce for the policy community accessible to as wide an audience as possible. So with that, thank you for your attention, and I'd love to have questions.